Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Autumn's Traitor by Hannah Parker, narrated by Gail Shalan. Part 1. Allies and Enemies. 1. Dahi, Erodian. Two sides of the same coin, people had always said about him and Finder. They looked more alike than their twin fathers. Yet as a boy, Dahi had longed to look more like his cousin. He would have given anything to have Finder's green eyes and dark auburn curls instead of his own brown gaze and light red hair. Everything Finder did, Dahi also wanted to do. But they were not boys any longer. Finder stood on a raised dais in the middle of the throne room. The weeping metal chains wrapped around his wrists and throat prevented him from moving or using his powers. The skin beneath the metal was red and oozing. The white linen of his shirt was rumpled and dirty from days in the dungeon, and his red curls were matted with sweat and blood. General Redon shifted beside Dahi, where they sat with the rest of the council facing the dais. Dahi wasn't a member of the council, but they had invited him to participate in Finder's trial. Redon's long black hair slipped over his breastplate. He was young, but level-headed, and it hadn't surprised Dahi when he had been elected. He caught Dahi's gaze and inclined his head. Dahi and Redon had trained together as swordsmen at the Autumn Court's military academy. Redon's estate had fallen on hard times the previous year, and Dahi had offered to let him repay his debts to the crown by working as a swordsmaster at the academy. Dahi had been close to Redon ever since and knew the male was loyal to him. Dahi gazed out at the crowd. The room was packed with hundreds of fae. They hovered between the double row of white marble columns running from the front of the room to the doors in the back. The columns were carved to look like massive tree trunks, their branches sweeping high into the domed ceiling. How many times had he and Finder played in this room as children? Weaving between the columns, running their hands along the marble trunks. So lifelike, they felt as rough as real tree bark. How many times had they laid beneath the branches, staring at leaves carved from stone and glass, light streaking through the orange and red hues? General Pike droned on, going over the details of their journey, filling in the Autumn Court Fae about the starveling's death. Dahi's stomach was in knots, half from the trial's proceedings, and half from the oath that pulled at his gut, demanding he return the knife to the guardian. The council had decided that he must give the knife of power to them. Anxiety had spiked through him at the thought of being separated from the knife, but he knew he would find a way to retrieve it, especially if the trial went as planned. "Soon," he told the oath. Only a week had passed since Dahi had brought Finder to Shadeshelm. His gaze caught on the puckered wound marring the skin between Finder's collarbone and shoulder. The wound should have healed by now. After all, it wasn't meant to be a mortal wound. But the weeping metal hindered its progress. Dahi remembered pulling his sword from Finder's chest and his cousin's subsequent cry of pain.
"Finder never wanted to rule,"
Dahi reminded himself firmly.
"Attacked by the Dark Priestesses. One of the three Dark Sisters gave Finder a knife of great power and sent him to a being known as the Guardian."
The Guardian had assured Dahi that once Finder spoke the words, the knife's power would overwhelm him and that Finder's powers would come to Dahi. And it had almost worked, until the human girl, Larkin, had brought Finder back. Dahi drummed his fingers on the table. Larkin. A glimmer of respect flared to life in his gut. He'd grown to care for the human girl, but he would not allow her to stand in his way. Dahi wanted, no, needed to rule the Autumn Court. He deserved it more than anyone. Until he could figure out how to take Finder's powers, however, his only hope was to rule as regent in his stead.
"Finder used the Guardian's knife to murder our king," Pike said.
A murmur rose from the crowd. They knew the Starveling was dead, but they hadn't heard the details of his demise until now. Pike clasped Dahi's shoulder.
Dahi was right to bring this treasonous act to the council.
Dahi nodded, ignoring Finder's glare from the dais.
May I speak in my defense before you decide my fate? Finder asked softly.
Pike extended his hand, gesturing for Finder to continue.
Do not pretend that the Starveling was some benevolent king,
Finder spat.
He never cared about the well-being of the Autumn Court. He only emerged from his den for the Tithe, which was agonizing for all the court rulers.
Why did you kill him?
Redon asked.
As Pike explained, I was tied in a life debt.
Yes, we know about Larkin.
Redon waved a hand.
But even then, you could have gone to the Starveling and begged for his mercy. He demanded that we bring him the hearts of innocent girls,
Finder grabbled.
Does he seem like a merciful being? The sacrifice of so many young girls is regrettable,
Redon said.
But the Tithe was a burden you should have been willing to bear for your court. We don't need a ruler who shrinks from his responsibilities. And there is the matter of Ember Nivalen's death.
Dahi's breath caught. Embrun, Finder's dearest friend, who had died when they had tried to rise up against the Starveling once before. But she had been Dahi's friend, too. He remembered wisps of her dark hair, her crushed elderberry scent.
Don't, Finder whispered. It is difficult to believe that this wasn't an act of revenge,
Redon finished.
A ploy that could have cost us all our lives.
Dahi smiled. His nerves melted away. His court was on his side.
Enough. Let us vote, Pike said. Those in favor of declaring Finder Fairborn unfit to rule.
Every member of the council raised their hands. Shocked gasps rose from the crowd. The murmurs grew into a roar. Pike stood.
Silence! For crimes of treason against his court and killing the Starveling, we declare Finder Fairburn unfit to rule. Finder, you will be imprisoned until your powers give us a new ruler. Dahi Fairburn will rule as your regent in your stead.
Dahi closed his eyes, shutting out the look of rage that marred his cousin's face. But a smile still touched Dahi's lips. He was going to be regent. And once he figured out how to take Finder's powers, he would be king. Despite it all, a tiny sigh of relief escaped him. There had been a chance the court would rule that Finder should be executed for his crimes. Dahi had never wanted to see his cousin dead. Even when the knife had overpowered Finder, he had wanted his cousin to live. All he wanted were the powers.
No, Finder snarled. I'm the only one who knows the true history of the Guardian, thanks to the breaking of the Starveling's memory curse. I will protect this court.
Be quiet,
Dahi snapped. His cousin had never cared about this court. Not like Dahi did.
He's going to take the powers from me,
Finder spat, jerking against the weeping metal chains. More murmurs from the crowd. Dahi glanced around, his heart beating quicker in his chest.
Impossible,
Redon snapped. Dahi's shoulders relaxed.
The magic chooses the ruler. You should know that more than anyone, seeing as how much you loathe ruling this court. We honor our rulers because the magic chooses them, and you have abused that privilege.
Pray your powers leave you soon, Pike said. We declared Osirin Fairburn unfit to rule, and soon after the powers sought another. I suspect things will not be any different this time.
Dahi jerked at his father's name. He couldn't stop himself from searching for his face in the crowd. But his father wasn't there.
I know how to use the powers. A new ruler will have to be trained, Finder said. Dahi betrayed his Durinan bond. Do you want a regent who would stoop so low to overthrow their prince?
Again, what you speak of is impossible, Pike snapped. No one can break a Durnin bond. Dahi already told us that you released him from his oath, and we will train on a new ruler as we always have.
Dahi clenched his fists. It didn't matter that he needed to be trained. He would train day and night until he mastered the powers. It would be a joy to learn them. He would respect and use the magic, while Finder had only ever shunned it. His court needed a ruler who would use the powers to protect them, not someone who would hide them away.
You need me, Finder said firmly. We need a ruler who wants to rule, Redon said coldly.
The corner of Dahi's lip lifted. Guards unlocked Finder's chains from the dais and began dragging him away. A pang of sadness struck Dahi's heart. His cousin would never be free of those chains again. Once Dahi took the magic, he would never allow Finder to go free, would never allow him to spread the word that Dahi had taken the powers by force, or go to the Guardian to try to get them back.
Your greed will destroy this court,
Finder snarled at Dahi.
I'm going to save this court, Dahi said, smoothing his coat. I've done everything for my people.
He knew he had to be strategic about how he took the magic. He couldn't let his court know it was possible to take a court ruler's powers, especially when it would already look suspicious that the powers had chosen another member of his family. It was why he had spent so long gaining his court's loyalty. Dahi couldn't risk their anger if he knew they had taken the magic by force. He walked out of the throne room. It was time to fulfill his oath to the Guardian. 2. Kaisa, Elvire. Kaisa gritted her teeth as her sword slammed against Tullus's blade. Luckily, the swords didn't make a sound due to the padded leather. They weren't allowed to be out past curfew without a pass, which, of course, they didn't have. The skin on her back twinged at the thought of the lashes they would get if they were found.
Stop thinking about getting lashes,
Hollis whacked her with his blade.
You never get them anyway.
Kaisa grinned. He was right. There had been many times when Kaisa had escaped punishment. She was at the top of all her classes. Her tutors adored her.
The most skilled student they've seen in centuries,
Giovanna called from where she sat, cross-legged in the dirt, watching them spar. Kaisa's chambermaid bared her teeth in a grin, and Kaisa smiled back. Giovanna might be her opposite in every way, pale skin to Kaisa's ebony, bone thin to Kaisa's soft curves, irresponsible to Kaisa's discipline, but she was one of her dearest friends. The balmy night air brushed against Kaisa's sweat-soaked skin. Though they were outside, sobs could be heard from the open window of the Cradle Girls' dormitory behind them. The cries always began after the girls were locked in for the night. The sound echoed against the unforgiving brick and stone walls of the Institute. Kaisa remembered what it had been like as a cradle at 5 years old, just learning the ways of the Order of the Twins. She hadn't appreciated it then. She hadn't known how good she had it. A roof over her head, a warm bed to sleep in, an education. And above all, being able to work for her two powerful gods, Alea and Asphalion. And the four popes who spoke their will. If it hadn't been for the order and for the pope's generosity, she would be starving on the streets. Many children were. The Institute did not take everyone, only those with potential, only those who were blessed by the twins. Her heart glowed at the thought. And while she might not receive lashes, she didn't want Giovanna and Hollis to be punished.
We need to leave. They'll be checking the dormitories soon, Kaisa said.
The Institute was strict about children maintaining their virtue until they were 18 years of age. Opposite sexes were not allowed in each other's chambers after nightfall. When a child became a student at the Institute of the Order, their body and soul were given in servitude to the twins.
Please, Kai, just a while longer, Hollis begged. I'll have to apply to the Black Guard once I'm anointed, and I haven't got the time to practice. But he's been working me to the bone. I've probably got time to oil and sharpen everything he wants.
I don't have time for training.
All the students of the Institute went through the same training, but Bade, the weapons maker, had taken a special interest in Hollis when he was a cradle.
I've told you, not at night. I'm exhausted, and I've got a long day tomorrow. Please,
Hollis begged, his brown eyes turning a nauseating shade of pitiful.
This is the only time I've got. If Bade knew I was applying, he'd have my hide. He wants me to take his place as weapons maker after I'm anointed.
You still haven't told him? Kaisa groaned.
You know I'm rubbish at confronting people.
Hollis crossed his arms.
If you want someone to stir the pot, ask Giovanna.
He jerked his head at their domineering, hot-headed friend. The three of them had been as thick as thieves since their cradle year. They did everything together, including reaching their scholar year. Only a select few made it to their final year, the rest being left to perform other servant duties. Giovanna grinned, cracking her knuckles.
Let me be the one to tell Bade, she pleaded. I'd give anything to see the look on his face when he realizes his prize student wants to leave.
I don't know how to tell him that weapons maker will be below my station once I'm anointed, Hollis said. There's no point in me telling him until I pass the test.
Entries aren't a secret, Hollis. If you don't tell him, he'll hear it from someone else first,
Kaisa pointed out.
Well, then I have to be good enough to pass this test in order to deal with any of that, don't I? So will you stay?
Kaisa looked at Giovanna, who shrugged.
Lashes are good for the soul, as they say. Well, good for my soul, I suppose.
Kaisa rolled her eyes, but picked up her blade once more. She and Hollis exchanged a few more blows.
Why do you want to join the Blackguard anyway?
Kaisa whined.
Everything you ever need is here in Barrensmere, including me and Joe.
The Institute, the school that trained children to become members of the Order, resided within the palace in the city of Barrensmere, and had been Kaisa's home since she was 5 years old. The Order might be strict, but it had given her everything. A family of tutors and friends when her own parents had turned their backs on her.
You know I want to protect Elvire from the Fae, Hollis said, swinging his sword again.
Kaisa shifted to block him.
But I don't want you to go north,
Kaisa moaned. She didn't want Hollis to be locked away for years, learning the lore of the Fae and put through grueling trials, only to be shipped off to the north. Not when they could make a life here after they were anointed. Hollis swatted her thigh with his blade, breaking her out of her thoughts.
Ouch,
she hissed. Hollis grinned.
Pay more attention.
They continued sparring, Hollis outmaneuvering her with skill that was almost terrifying. He was good, too good at fighting to have his skills wasted once he was anointed. He needed to be in the Black Guard. After a few stinging blows from Hollis, most of which she was too tired to block or dodge, she collapsed on the ground, her chest heaving. Hollis flopped to the ground beside her. He tugged at the strap holding back his hair and let it fall in sweaty tendrils to his shoulders. His eyes were a bit too far apart to be handsome, the rest of his features too pinched, but she loved every bit of him as much as her own flesh and blood. Hollis had been her first friend in her cradle year. He had a large family in town, but they had no time for him, no food for another mouth.
Mother,
Kaisa screamed as soldiers swathed in black and blood-red fabric hauled Kaisa away. Silver coins falling into her mother's hands, so many that they spilled onto the cobblestone. Kaisa shoved those thoughts away, ignoring the deep ache in her chest. Sold. She could never forget the true word for it. Their families had sold them. Now they were each other's family, the three of them.
Are you nervous?
Hollis asked, wiping sweat from his neck.
About what?
Kaisa replied, though she already knew what he referred to.
About what?
Hollis mimicked, shoving her arm.
Oh, I don't know. Maybe about our anointing? It's only 2 days away.
I can't think about it.
Kaisa scratched her nail in the dirt. The anointing was the final test they took as scholars. If they passed, they were inducted as full members of the Order, and they could apply for the highest-ranking jobs. Less than half of each scholar class completed their anointing, and the rest were carted off in the dead of night in disgrace, forced to perform servant's duties at one of the Order's many outpost colonies.
Thinking about it will interfere with my work?
She was so close to achieving all she had ever dreamed. She worked harder than any other student at the Institute. She was the most accomplished scholar her tutors had ever seen. Everyone in Elvire worshipped the twins, but only those who made it through the Institute were allowed to work within the Order. Boys who completed their lessons at the Institute became members of the Black Guard, who guarded Elvire from the Fae, the Red Guard, who protected the Popes, or teachers of the faith, who could teach the ways of the Order. Girls became sisters of the Order and taught at the Institute, or they could become members of the Black Guard if they were ruled Baron. But Kaisa didn't want to become a sister of the Order or a member of the Black Guard. No, Kaisa wanted to rise above them all and become a Pope's page. Her heart leapt at the thought. She would be the right hand of Pope Cerseus, the ruler of Baronsmere, higher in station than sisters of the Order, teachers of the faith, and even the Black and Red Guards. The Pope's page was a revered position, and Kaisa wanted it more than anything.
I wish I could master my mind like that, Giovanna muttered. Order myself not to think about something.
It doesn't work all the time, Kaisa wanted to say. If it did, she wouldn't be plagued by her mother's face. Wouldn't see her delight reflected in her handful of silver coins as Kaisa was dragged away. She wouldn't be haunted by thoughts of the secretive anointing ritual. Her stomach twisted.
I'm going to prove it to them, she murmured, more to herself than Hollis and Giovanna. I'm going to prove all of them wrong, that I can make it to my anointing, that they were wrong to give me up.
We were children, Kai, Hollis said softly. It wasn't our fault they gave us up.
Kaisa rested her chin on her knees, wrapping her arms around her shins. Maybe. Maybe if she had been a more obedient child, her parents wouldn't have given her up. A slow ache spread across her chest. She should have worked harder.
Your fault,
a voice whispered in the back of her head. Kaisa shoved her sadness down deep inside her. Thoughts like that would only distract her from her task.
I've got to sleep, Kaisa said, hoisting herself upright. She hauled Hollis and Giovanna up as well. I'm covering Rachel's shift tomorrow morning.
Pride swept through her. Kaisa had worked hard to be promoted to care for the Pope, a task only the most devoted scholars were allowed to do. But that wasn't good enough for Kaisa. She needed to become his page. She and Giovanna rushed back to their room. A few blights stopped Kaisa on the way back, asking her how to set up for the morning service. Kaisa explained it to them in detail, putting their minds at ease. They finally made it back to their room. The brown walls were devoid of all warmth, the room only big enough to fit her and Giovanna's beds. Kaisa pulled back the taupe curtain that shielded her mattress. She froze. On the quilt lay a small card inscribed with delicate script. Scholar Kaisa, congratulations on your anointing. May the twins watch over you. Pope Cerseus. Signed by the Pope himself, an honor she had never heard in doubt upon any scholar before. Kaisa fell to her knees, clasped her hands together, and sent thanks to the twins. In 2 days, she was going to be anointed. She was going to be a true member of the Order. Not just some rat her parents had sold the first opportunity they'd had. No, the twins had chosen her for something special. They had plucked her from the rabble and given her a choice. Stay in the life she was born to, or rise above. Now, she would rise. 3. Larkin, Erodian. Larkin's teeth chattered more from nerves than the chill. Saj's breath billowed before him, snow still caked in his beard. Blue tiles lined the frosted stone walls, making the room glow faintly. A throne sat upon a raised dais, a huge slab of sharp ice. It cut upwards in a diagonal slash, every shade of blue and white imaginable marbled within. The jagged tips looked like blades, and Larkin knew without a doubt that if she were to place a finger on one of the edges, it would draw blood. But it was the queen sitting upon the throne who they had come to see. She radiated such power that it rippled through the air, filling the space to the vaulted ceiling. A tall, spiked crown of ice rested on her head. Despite its obvious weight, she bore it effortlessly. She tilted her head, her short white hair almost blue from the light of the crown. She sat upright on the throne, her hands loose on the armrests of the chair. Her gown was skin tight, glittering as though it was made up of hundreds of shards of ice. It had taken them what felt like an eternity to reach the Winter Court capital city, White Keep. Larkin despised the constant cold, but she couldn't deny the beauty of the city. Their journey through the Winter Court had given them all the information they needed, that Finder had been declared unfit to rule and was imprisoned at Shadeshelm, and Dahi ruled as regent in his stead. Larkin's fists clenched at her sides. Saja believed that Finder was relatively safe, for now. But they knew Dahi would not rest until he had the powers, and that he would seek the Guardian's Council to find out how to take them. They just had to hope that Dahi had not taken them already. Saja approached the dais, Larkin quickening her step to keep pace with his longer strides. She had been at the big warrior's side for weeks, refusing to let him out of her sight. He was all she had left. Her parents were in Bellamore. Madden was dead. Finder was imprisoned, and Dahi had betrayed them. Her heartbeat quickened at the thought of losing Saja, at the thought of being alone in Erodian. She bit the inside of her cheek. Focus, she reminded herself. Their footsteps were quiet on the marble, making Larkin feel incredibly small. It was like walking through a snow-covered forest when a hush was draped over the entire world.
Queen Isra.
Saja bowed, and Larkin hastily dropped into a curtsy. Isra rose from her throne and approached them, sauntering down the steps.
Saja Rok,
Isra said warmly. Larkin blinked. She hadn't heard Saja's surname before, hadn't known that the Fae even used surnames. Saja smiled, clasping forearms with the Winter Court Queen. Isra was more beautiful up close. She had a round, pale face and high cheekbones. Angular eyebrows framed light blue eyes. Her hair was a striking stark white, shaved almost to the scalp on the sides, but longer on top. Shards of ice glittered through her hair, making the strands gleam in the light. Larkin's gut twisted in anticipation. Saja had said that Finder and the Queen were old friends. But how could he be so certain that Isra wouldn't betray them?
We thought Dahi was our friend too, she thought bitterly.
His betrayal was still lodged in her heart like a blade. She felt it with every pulsing beat. Still, the Queen was their most powerful potential ally. She had the magic, resources, and soldiers. They hoped that she would talk to Dahi and demand that he release Finder. And if that failed, lend them the soldiers they needed to free Finder by force. Larkin's heart sank. The plan had seemed so solid during their travels. But now, faced with the Queen, Larkin wondered if they had been fools to come here. Isra hadn't helped them in their battle against the Starveling. So why would she choose to help them now? But Larkin had to cling to her last shred of hope.
How does it feel to be a queen, my friend?
Saja asked. Damn good, I must say. Isra grinned.
She looked as if she were about to say more, her eyes darkening. Then she stopped herself, turning towards Larkin instead.
Forgive me. My name is Esra, Queen of the Winter Court. I'm Larkin McClary. I'm from Balamor in the Human Realm.
Esra took her hand and squeezed it gently. Welcome to the White Keep, Larkin. Rumors have been flying through Rodian of late that Finder has been put on trial for crimes against his court. They say his cousin, Dahi, has taken up the role as regent, and that he rules with a heavy heart.
That's a lie, Larkin spat.
Isra's eyebrows rose.
Dahi planned this from the beginning. He always wanted to rule the Autumn Court.
Larkin, I understand your anger, but surely you know that even if Dahi wanted to be king, there is no way to guarantee that the powers would have passed to him. Why would he attempt to usurp Finder without the guarantee that he would become king in his stead? Larkin bit the inside of her cheek. Isra knew about the Guardian's perverse language. Surely she could guess that it would be capable of such things.
Finder has been put on trial unfairly, Saja said. We've come to ask for your aid in freeing him.
Isra studied them. He was put on trial for killing the Starvlin. I've no idea why Finder would put his court at risk by staging a direct attack on our king. Tied to the stones, unable to move, Finder exploding with power, the flames burning her, burning everything as she screamed and tried to escape. Larkin shook her head, ignoring the black spots swimming at the edges of her vision. Something was wrong with her. She could barely breathe around a flame, and she had made Saja douse their evening fires as they had traveled to the Winter Court more than once, just because the scent of the smoke made her gag violently. Even talking about the night they had fought the Starvelin caused her breath to hitch, and the other day, when she and Saja had discussed it, she had nearly fainted on the back of Saja's horse, Aroven.
Finder will know some way to heal you, she told herself. He healed your body from the flame. He can also heal your mind. Once you get him back, all your fears will disappear, Larkin told herself.
He had no choice.
A muscle jumped in Saja's jaw. Larkin shifted.
They hadn't come here to reveal the exact details of why Finder overthrew the Starveling, or how the Guardian's knife came into play.
Isra could still turn them over to Dahi and forge an alliance with the new regent.
A shift of power so quickly after the Starvelin's demise is not much cause for question, nor do I disagree with the fact that Finder put his court at risk by attacking him. That being said, I do believe there is something strange happening in the Autumn Court, as well as in all of Erotian, Isra said carefully. I wish to speak to you both at length about it, as well as my fellow court rulers, before making any decisions. Finder has been my friend for many years. Beyond that, I believe he is a good ruler. I have no remorse for the Starvelin's demise, as his tithe was taxing on me. Still, to involve the Winter Court could put my people at risk. I will think on your words, and we will talk later. Over our evening meal, perhaps? For now, you have had a long journey, and I would be most pleased if you would stay in the White Keep as my guests.
Larkin's heart leapt into her throat. No, they had come all this way. Isra had to help them.
Please, my queen, Larkin tried to keep the raw desperation from her voice. We know of no one else who can help us.
Their only allies were the Warga, a clan of female shapeshifters that had helped them on their journey to find the Guardian. But they lived far to the northeast in the wild. Larkin had already suggested that they ask the leader of the Warga clan, Ramira, for help, but Saja had told her that the wolf shifters had no sway in court politics, and that their clan was too small to help them free Finder by force.
I will not speak of the matter until later, Isra said, a touch of ice coating her words.
Larkin's heart sank. It was a pleasure meeting you, Larkin, Isra said, as guards came in and ushered them from the throne room. 4. Dahi, Erodian.
Dahi's legs moved of their own accord, marching him towards the being he had sworn his oath to. Surprise rippled over him when his oath led him to the stone circle. Well, if he thinks he can replace the Starvelin, he'll realize how wrong he is, Dahi thought to himself. Without the Starveling, the court rulers had no checks on their power. Dahi would not serve under another king. Dahi pressed his lips together, his hand drifting to the bundle of cloth wrapped at his belt. He knew there was more to the weapon than the guardian let on, else he would not want it back so desperately. Dahi hadn't dared to touch the naked blade. The power was tempting, yes, but he'd seen how easily Finder had been overcome. Dahi remembered the power Finder had commanded as he wielded the knife against the Starveling, how his cousin had exploded into a pillar of pure fire. No, Dahi would not touch the blade. He had no desire to perish beneath the flame. He wanted to command the flame. A chittering sound made the hair on the back of his neck rise. A creature emerged from slender trees. It was white and hairless, with sagging, wrinkly skin. Spines protruded from its head and back. It opened its beak and emitted another chittering sound.
Master has returned, it said.
Dahi nodded stiffly at the Famari. The guardian had taught him how to make a deal with the creatures, and they had obeyed him, killing Finder's Tithe girl and attempting to trap Saja and Larkin at the bridge.
You owe us what was promised, the Famari said. Flesh.
He had promised the creatures flesh, either human or fey. He had no fairy flesh to give them, nor would he ever sacrifice members of his court to the Famari. But the humans, he didn't care about.
The bridge is open, he said. Take your kin to Elvir and feast, but then our bargain is done.
He had no desire to work with the foul creatures any longer. The Famari chittered happily.
As you command, master.
The Famari disappeared into the trees, more shrieking calls echoing through the sickly forest. Dahi shoved down his guilt. They would surely go to Larkin's village first, as it was the closest to the bridge.
You owed them what was promised, he reminded himself. It was human flesh or the flesh of your court, and you would never put your people at risk.
Smoothing down his jacket, Dahi entered the stone circle. His mind jerked back to the last time he had seen the guardian in the wild. Then, the sky had been dark with glamour. Then, Larkin had been with them, and Saja, and Madden. Dahi's lip curled. How dare Finder take everything from him, put his Dornan at risk? They had sworn to protect Finder, had tied their souls to him so they could feel when one of their companions was hurt or dead, and he had abused that power. It was Finder's fault that Madden was dead. Dahi swallowed around the ache in his throat. He didn't need Saja or Madden. He didn't need Finder. He didn't need anyone.
The Autumn Court is about to enter a new age, and I shall be the one to lead it.
Not his father, not Finder, him. Dahi would be the one to lead it to glory. His kin had never deserved the honor of being ruler of the Autumn Court. Neither of them had wanted it. Trees burning with flame, his father screaming, hands lifted to the sky as it rained ash.
Father, please,
Dahi cried. He had woken up in the nursery alone, choking on smoke. He thought the world was ending, but his father was the source of the blaze. His father turned to him, his features cold and hard as cut glass.
Please,
Dahi whispered.
I'm scared.
His father knelt, his robes pooling beneath him. He opened his arms and Dahi ran to him, shivering in his father's embrace. His father was cold, though the fire raged around them.
I will make you strong, his father whispered. I will burn the fear itself from inside you.
The cold that surrounded his father slowly ebbed, warming until his skin became hot to the touch. Dahi squirmed, but his father held him tight. Held him as the flames leapt from his skin, consuming Dahi with its touch. And then, all Dahi knew was blind agony as his father burned him. Dahi screamed for his mother, screamed for Finder. But that night, as with so many others, no one had been there to save him. Dahi had seen what power did to a weak mind, saw how it turned his father to madness and Finder into a fool. But the fire hadn't wanted his father. It had left once it realized how corrupt its vessel had become. It had chosen Finder instead, but it had chosen wrong. Finder feared the powers. Finder had constantly rebelled against his rule instead of treasuring it. If Dahi had gotten tangled in a life debt to a human as Finder had, he would have gone to the Starveling and begged for forgiveness. He would have died for his court, if necessary. But it had all worked out in Dahi's favor. The Starveling was dead, and now Dahi would have no limits to his power. Finder thought he had suffered because of his powers, but he didn't know the true pain the flames could cause. Dahi did. He was the only one who understood. He was the only one who deserved and respected its power. He straightened his shoulders. Finder had rejected his power over fire and death, but Dahi would embrace it, use it as Finder and his father never could, for the good of his court. He didn't see the guardian approach, but rather felt another presence join his. Dahi spun around.
Little regent, come to see me at last.
Dahi frowned, trying not to let the title annoy him. He wondered briefly how the guardian knew that he was regent. No matter. Likely he had spies along with the rest. The guardian looked the same. His hood drawn low over his face, concealing his features. A voice that sounded like rocks sliding against each other. At least he was no longer cursed to speak in those wretched rhymes. The hairs on the back of Dahi's neck rose, as did a fierce desire to discover what was under the hood.
I will be king soon enough, Dahi said, aiming for what he hoped was a civil tone.
He had no desire to fight with the guardian. He simply wanted information, and then the guardian could have his knife. He clenched his sweating palms. The oath demanded that he return the knife. Dahi could only beg for answers.
No, a king does not beg. A king demands.
Have you come to fulfill our bargain?
The guardian's hooded head tilted.
Yes,
Dahi replied smoothly, letting his hand rest on his scabbard.
Once you have upheld your end of the agreement.
Have I not given you everything you desire? You brought your cousin to his knees and dragged him away in chains. The Starveling is dead, and you rule the Autumn Court. Have I not done everything you've asked?
And yet, you just mentioned your own failure. You said the knife's magic would make Finder's powers choose me.
I couldn't tell you everything, little regent. I didn't know if you would have the gall to go through with your plan. A need for answers ensured that you returned to me, even if your courage failed.
You made me swear an oath,
Dahi growled. The guardian chuckled.
Another precaution.
Are you going to tell me or not?
Dahi seethed.
There is a way to force the magic's hand,
the guardian said,
though it will not be pleasant. It has never been attempted by a fairy before, but I am curious to know the results. It could be the beginning of something extraordinary.
Tell me,
Dahi snapped before he could help himself.
Return my knife.
Dahi carefully untied the bundle from his belt.
And the powers can be forced without,
he swallowed.
Without Finder's death?
Yes.
A smile touched the guardian's words. Dahi's heart began to pound. The language this being had created was unnatural. And it didn't slip Dahi's notice how easily the guardian was offering up the information.
almost like he wanted Dahi to use it. The second the guardian lifted a finger against his court, Dahi would find a way to end him. But he needed the powers. He needed to be king. He had to protect his people, and this was the only way. He knew the guardian believed he could manipulate him, but the guardian had no idea who he was dealing with. Dahi knew how to stay one step ahead, always. He handed the bundle to the guardian.
Tell me what I have to do.
5. The Guardian, Erodian. The guardian spoke his language, relishing the way his tongue curled around the words, flying through the phrases. He carved with his knife, parting flesh and making it anew. It was like stretching a muscle that had been cramped in place for centuries. The starveling had twisted the guardian's words into a rhyming curse as punishment, so he couldn't speak his beloved language. The starveling had feared the guardian's language, hated how he had given power to those his father deemed lesser. He had revolted against his father once, and had failed. The starveling, dark priestesses, and the court rulers had imprisoned him. But he was free now. Not that his father was alive to see it. His father had scorned him since he was a babe. His father had only ever cared for power and had seen him as weak. He would show his father power. The guardian looked up from his work, breathing in deeply. The scent of rot and decay greeted him. Sharp stones and gnarled shrubs littered the ground. The trees were pale and sickly, their branches cold as ice. It was as if the earth had wanted to reject his father. He had returned to his father's domain, the stone circle where the starveling had called the tithe, to perform his work. Yes, he would take up his father's mantle of ruler, but he would become more than his father ever could have imagined. The guardian lifted his hands from his work. It had been a tree dryad once. Now, it was something more. His language had transformed her into something great. Her face had flattened, her skin turning from molten tree bark to striped flesh. She raised her tattered wings. The Furions had all been killed in the Second War, but now they would rise again. He would need flying beasts to spread his message. The creature bowed.
Master.
The guardian smiled. In days of old, mind speak was common between the ancients. He gave it as a gift to his creations.
Soon, all creatures will be equal. No more power dynamics, as things were with my father.
He cooed to his new Furion. His father had relished in the fact that he was the most powerful being in all of Erodian. He'd seen everything and everyone as beneath him, even his own son. He had sucked power from the court rulers. The starveling had controlled all under his rule and punished all, even those who were obedient to him.
No kings, no court rulers, only power for everyone.
The court rulers didn't concern him. Obsessed with their petty squabbles, they didn't have the strength to stand against him. Only when they combined their powers with the starveling and the dark priestesses had they been able to imprison him. A seedling of doubt crept into his mind. They could ally themselves with other creatures of old, beings who might have the strength to stand against him. The guardian shook his head. No, he would go to his allies from the war first. The court rulers would fall in line, either by choice or by force. If they refused to join him, his army would sweep through and crush them. He had already turned his sights toward his first target, and once their court fell, the rest would submit. He would free magic for all. Then none would have to suffer as he had. But he would keep just enough of the language to himself to ensure he was never imprisoned again. The guardian pulled a round onyx stone from his robes. His father's orb. Each of the court rulers had two orbs, one that could speak to their respective pope, and the other that could talk to the starveling.
Yet the starveling possessed an orb that could communicate with any of the popes and any of the court rulers simultaneously. The guardian had already been in communication with the rulers of Alvir and had told them about the starveling's demise. He placed his hand on the orb.
Have you accepted my offer?
After a moment, a chorus of voices answered from the orb, all talking over one another. The guardian swallowed his irritation. Yes, he would banish hierarchies, but the humans, they were far beneath him. Any who refused to join him would become fodder for his army.
We need more time,
one finally said. The guardian recognized his voice. Pope Cerseus.
No waiting, the guardian snapped. I will have the human world as well, but until I can figure out how to heal the chasm, my Furions will serve as my eyes and ears. Their presence will be unpleasant. I suggest you use them as incentive for your people to join your army. Once you and your people join me, they will be safe. Until then, my Furions will consume whomever they please.
He released the orb. He didn't need the popes on his side, but if he was to take Elvir, it would make things easier. A second army, rallying the humans to his side so they didn't flock to the Fae as they had during the First and Second Wars. He turned to his Furion.
Fly,
he commanded, and the beast took to the sky, wings pounding towards Elvir. He turned to the next dryad.
Please,
she begged, but he ignored her cries. He would build his army. Once he used his language on his creatures, they were completely devoted to him. His father had made the courts forget him, aside from the court rulers, so he would have to spend precious time building his army. But soon, all of Erodian and Elvir would know him by his true name, Zegon. 6. Larkin, Erodian. Larkin sat on the snowy ground, watching the cinnatas spin their webs. She only left her room at White Keep to go on a freezing walk in the game park. To her delight, she found that the winter court had cinnatas, the spider creatures that spun art in their webs. She and the rest of her companions had stumbled across them during their quest to find the guardian. A bolt of pain shot through Larkin's heart. Not long ago, she had spoken to another cinnata with Finder at her side. He had wanted to show her something beautiful in Erodian. She glanced at the trees, almost able to hear her companion's laughter filtering through the boughs. One gray-speckled cinnata began a portrait of Larkin. It captured her perfectly. Round face, upturned nose, her mass of curly blonde hair, though in the web the strands were silver. The cinnata paused, then began strumming frantically on its web. Larkin watched as the threads vibrated, sending ripples to the web next to it. The neighboring cinnata gave a little giggle and strummed something back. An idea spiked through her, and Larkin scrambled to her feet.
Can you communicate with other cinnatas through your web?
Larkin asked the gray-speckled cinnata. The tiny creature nodded. Larkin motioned to a web opposite them.
These messages, how far can they travel?
To any cinnata web in Erodian,
the cinnata chirped, clearly pleased that Larkin was happy. She and Saja had been searching for a way to get a message to Finder, but had no way to do so while Finder was in the Shadeshelm dungeons. But if there were cinnatas in the winter court, there had to be some in the autumn court as well. She could let Finder know that they hadn't given up on him, that they were searching for a way to free him, and that he just had to hold on a little while longer.
Can you send a message for me?
7. Kaisa, Elvir. Giovanna didn't move when Kaisa woke the next morning. Kaisa had to be up earlier than normal for Rachel's shift. Students at the Institute had no days off, but whenever a student fell ill, Kaisa covered for them. While Rachel was a scholar as well, she wasn't quite as distinguished as Kaisa, so she mainly cleaned and prepared prayer rooms and delivered food to the prisoners. Kaisa tried not to wrinkle her nose.
No task is menial when done in service to the twins. She hurried down to the palace kitchens, making a breakfast tray for Pope Cerseus. The kitchen staff prepared the food, but they didn't make the tray. That was Kaisa's job, and she took it seriously. Kaisa carefully filled the tray. 3 strips of bacon, soft-boiled eggs, brown bread with warm butter, 1 cake of black pudding, tea with enough sugar to make her teeth hurt. Once she became the Pope's page, she could devote herself entirely to caring for Pope Cerseus, tasting his meals, dressing him, delivering messages, traveling with him. She would do it all until she or the Pope died. His last page had died several years before, and now he had no one, not wanting anyone from the previous scholar classes. Kaisa would prove that she was worth the wait. You are everything he's been waiting for, her tutors told her. The twins have given you a gift. You must not waste it. Keeping the tray perfectly level, she climbed the stairs to the Pope's chambers. She left the tray outside the massive wrought iron door. She breezed back to the kitchen, almost stumbling over a cradle who darted out of one of the corridors.
Kaisa?
The little girl blinked at her through long lashes. Kaisa knelt before the girl. Yes? Kaisa had seen her once before, the first time the girl had set foot in the institute after her parents had sold her. The girl rubbed her toe into the polished stone floor.
I didn't know who else to go to.
Her lip trembled.
I soiled my bed.
Kaisa's heart squeezed in her chest. If the girls were caught with a soiled bed, they had to sleep in it the following night. Kaisa took her hand. We'll take it to the laundry together, she said gently. The girl beamed up at her, and Kaisa's heart swelled. After helping the cradle girl with her sheets, Kaisa hurried back to the kitchens.
Kaisa?
A voice boomed. Kaisa's face broke out into a smile at her favorite tutor's voice. Sister Abatha had taught Kaisa during her cradle year. She was strict, but kind.
Sister Abatha?
Kaisa greeted her. The huge woman bustled towards Kaisa, pulling her into a tight hug.
I heard a whisper that one of my cradles was looking for you.
Sister Abatha eyed Kaisa.
Something about a soiled bed?
Kaisa shrugged.
A girl asked for directions to the laundry. I did nothing more.
Sister Abatha squeezed Kaisa's arm.
You have a servant's heart, Kaisa, she murmured. The twins have truly blessed you, one of my brightest pupils.
She shook her head.
We need you as a sister of the order, teaching the next generation of young ones.
She held up a hand before Kaisa could protest.
I know. You wish to become a Pope's page, and I can think of no one more worthy.
Kaisa squeezed the woman's hand. Thank you, Sister Abatha. Sister Abatha's eyes glistened.
Now, no more helping my cradles out of their punishments, you hear?
She said gruffly. Still, she softened her tone with a wink. Kaisa laughed, then hurried off to the kitchens to pick up the slop designated for the prisoners. She couldn't help her gag. The food wasn't worthy for the pigs. Moldy scraps scattered with maggots. She hefted the ladle and bucket, breathing through her mouth to avoid the stench. The order of the twins centered on justice, not mercy. The palace dungeons reflected that core virtue. If she thought the stench from the buckets was bad, nothing compared to the reek that clung to the stones of the dungeons. It had taken Kaisa years to get over her squeamish stomach. Like a gardener ripping out weeds by the roots to protect the tree, so did the popes call the non-believers to protect the faith. But everything they did for the twins. And the twins blessed true believers beyond measure. Her heart jumped. Only one more day until her anointing. Then she would prove to everyone that she was worth something. That her parents were wrong to throw her away like garbage. She could barely breathe when she thought about it. But she had a task to do now. She ladled the food through a slot in the doors. She tried to ignore the moans and the sounds of hands scraping slop from the floor. Kaisa let the sounds wash over her, let herself acknowledge their pain,
and sent a prayer to the twins for speedy suffering. It was necessary for them to come to the light of the twins. It was all necessary. She almost screamed when the ladle caught, dragging her arm up through the slat nearly to her elbow.
Stop,
a voice croaked. Kaisa released the handle and fell back. The ladle disappeared into the slat. No, she cried, crawling as close to the slender opening as she dared. The prisoner could hurt himself, or guard. Even she wouldn't be able to escape punishment for this.
I just want to talk,
the voice from the dark murmured.
To someone who isn't making me scream.
Give me the ladle, she said, much calmer than she felt, and I will. The voice, a man's voice, chuckled.
This ladle is the most power I've had in months. I'm not giving it up yet.
Kaisa scowled, but said nothing. If it was conversation he wanted, he wasn't about to get it.
You aren't the usual girl,
the voice mused.
Is she dead?
No, Kaisa blurted, aghast. The man chuckled again.
Force of habit. I'm used to death down here. Everyone dies in these cells eventually.
That's not true, Kaisa said. You can repent. Begin a new life in the light of the twins. Pope Cerseus had many prisoners, but none of them were in the dungeons for long. The majority of prisoners were accused of heresy, which had an easy solution: confession, then repentance. After confession, and depending on the seriousness of the crime, the accused could repent their crimes through various levels of pain. Ones who could not, or would not, repent were sentenced to death. Most of the prisoners here were in the midst of their repentance. The confession process didn't take long.
Start a new life without a couple of limbs, I'd reckon, or teeth, or a tongue.
Kaisa narrowed her eyes. No one said repentance was easy. You have to mean it.
Oh, I'm sure they all mean it. When the Brandon irons and knives come out, I would know. I was trained in torture, same as all the members of the Black Guard.
Kaisa's stomach dropped. This man had been a member of the Black Guard? To be in this dungeon meant he betrayed the twins, or his sacred duty in some way. How does a member of the Black Guard end up in Barrensmere's dungeon? Kaisa asked, her curiosity getting the better of her.
I found out a bit of information I shouldn't have. Then I tried to stop a bad thing from happening again, and I don't even know if I succeeded.
The voice broke.
I know you won't heed my advice, but since I can't seem to learn my lesson, I'm going to tell you anyway. Get out of here, girl. The guard knows some of the darkest secrets of the Order, and no part of it is safe. No part of it.
I'm to be an anointed member, Kaisa bristled. I came from nothing, and I will have everything. All of it is because of Pope Cerseus, because of the Order.
An anointed member?
The man's voice turned sharp.
And do you know what happens during the anointing? Have they told you that?
Of course not. Only those who have been anointed knows what occurs during the ritual.
What do you think they haven't told you? The man hissed. Because if people knew the truth about all these damn ceremonies, all these secrets, there wouldn't be an order at all.
Stop it! Kaisa cried, scrambling to her feet. You won't talk that way about my faith, heretic. You deserve to rot in this place. Silence dropped over them, disturbed only by the muffled sobbing and moans of the other prisoners. Nerves nipped at her. Her tutors had warned her that the task would be difficult. It was their final test, after all. But the anointing couldn't be bad. They wouldn't punish the scholars, not when they had made it so far. No, she would pass the test. She wouldn't be left to serve out her sentence at the outpost colonies in disgrace.
Maybe I do,
the voice finally said.
But I tried. I tried to make it right. And I can die with that knowledge. The question is, once you know the truth, can you live with it?
Part of her wanted to run from the dungeon and never return. Part of her wanted to drop to her knees and beg the man to tell her what he believed to be the truth. For some part of his words had wormed its way into her brain, making her doubt herself. She wasn't blind. She knew of the Order's brutality. But she had always been exempt. What if her luck finally ran out during the anointing? What if she failed? Her heart dropped to her toes. She couldn't fail. Not after she had come so far. Not when she was about to prove herself to her parents, her tutors, even Pope Cerseus himself.
No, I won't tell you, girl,
the voice said. Her heart fell at his words.
I ruined one girl's life with the truth already. Just leave after if you can. Try to forget. Because once you start digging up secrets, you can't forget them. And this religion isn't kind to those who discover them. But if you can't escape, or if you don't want to leave this life behind.
The ladle extended through the slot.
An anointing gift from Castor Longshanks.
8. Larkin, Erodian. Larkin and Saja followed a servant to Isra's private dining room, where they met alone with the queen. The room was gorgeous, slate gray with painted blue embellishments carved into swirling designs. The small dining table was made of glass. Isra sat at the head of the table, with Larkin and Saja on either side of her. Larkin twisted her hands in her lap. She had settled on a simple white gown that wrapped around her shoulders in an elegant twist. Her feet rested in jewel-encrusted shoes with a tiny heel. It was kind of the winter court queen to allow Larkin to borrow any clothes she needed. Isra tilted her head, her crown placed regally on her short white hair. Tall and jagged, the crown had molten gray and white crystal carved into a beautiful castle. Larkin squinted. It wasn't just a castle, it was an exact replica of White Keep. Isra noticed her stare and grinned.
Do you like it? It's incredible, Larkin said.
Isra removed her crown and placed it on the table for Larkin to inspect. The rim of the crown was the mountain range that surrounded White Keep. In the center rose the citadel itself, complete with minuscule markets, roads, and finally, the castle. Isra trailed a finger around the edges of the crown.
It is comforting to me to always have it with me. Whenever I leave White Keep, it is still with me. And it is quite literally always on my mind.
She smiled a coy grin.
Even the weather is the same. Luckily, you came on a cloudless day, lest you would barely be able to see the details of the town. The worst are the snowstorms. I hear the wind howling day and night through the spokes.
Isra pointed to the mountains, and Larkin smiled.
Is it glamour? Larkin asked.
Isra shook her head.
No, the crystal was mined from our mountains and contains magical properties. Long ago, the mines in the Winter Court mountains contained all kinds of magical oddities. When it was carved to look like White Keep, it took on the properties of the city of its own accord.
A servant leaned over her, placing a steaming platter of food on the table.
Thank you, Larkin said when he'd finished, smiling at him.
The servant gave her a smile and a small nod in return. The clattering of silver cutlery ensued as they helped themselves to the spread. Larkin went immediately for the stew, hoping that something warm would help ward off the constant chill she felt in the palace. It brimmed with spices and salt, thick and creamy with chunks of potato and onion. She went for the bread next, a thick brown bran that would rival her father's baking. No meat was found anywhere on the table. Like the autumn court, the winter court fae did not eat meat. After stuffing herself with bread, stew, lentil pastries, and 3 glasses of the hot spiced wine, Larkin thought she could eat and drink no more. That was, of course, until dessert was served. 4-layer chocolate cake with peppermint icing. Saja's eyes brightened, and Isra laughed, tipping her wine glass in a salute.
I happen to know that Saja loves chocolate, and the Winter Court has the finest chocolate in all of Erodian.
Isra smiled devilishly.
It's the only thing that makes him come back and visit me.
Larkin smiled at the queen.
She liked talking with Isra. She was open and easy to talk to. She knew that they had come to convince the queen to help free Finder, but perhaps Isra could help Larkin heal her mind. It felt personal, and after all, she didn't know the queen, but Larkin was desperate for her fear of fire to go away. As a court ruler, Isra would have the power to heal. If Isra could help her, then she wouldn't have to wait for Finder. Isra motioned for Larkin to help herself to the cake, and Larkin obliged her.
I appreciate you dining with me.
Isra smiled at them from behind the rim of her wine glass. She reached out to pour Larkin another glass, but Larkin covered the rim with her hand, shaking her head.
Don't tempt me, she moaned. I can already feel my head beginning to pound.
Isra chuckled. Fairy wine can do marvelous things and cause marvelous hangovers. Larkin smiled.
Thank you for preparing this meal for us. You've been so kind to allow us to stay here.
I know you were displeased at the end of our last meeting. Larkin fingered the rim of her glass. She tasted blood. Her tongue prodded the ruined flesh of her cheek, worn thin from constant chewing.
We understand it will take time to sway you to our cause, Larkin said. What can we do to make you consider helping us?
Isra's brows lowered thoughtfully.
You are a rather extraordinary girl, Larkin, she murmured. It is curious indeed that all of your fellow humans died that night of the Tithe, yet you remain. It is also curious that you happened to be the chosen human when Finder decided to overthrow the Starvlin, almost as if it were meant to be. You and Finder are connected somehow, or else why would you, the girl he chose to sacrifice, be here, pleading for his life?
Larkin's leg bounced beneath the table. Her soul had been tied to Finder's after she had saved his life, tangling them both in a life debt. She could still feel the phantom tug of the golden thread of magic that had bound them together. When one was cut, the other bled. A part of her now felt empty without him. Though it had been a relief when their life debt had ended, a part of her missed her bond with Finder, how they were never alone.
I'm nothing special, she said.
Isra leaned back, a slow smile crossing her lips.
Come now, I insist you elaborate on your extremely interesting story or I will be forced to other conclusions. Perhaps you wooed Finder and now come to me to save your lover's life, and I'm afraid I will not risk the lives of my people for romantic whims.
It's not like that, Larkin insisted. Her breath caught as she remembered Finder pressing his head into the crook of her neck as they rode, drawing her closer, his scent of crushed autumn leaves and spices. Saja cut in.
Do you really think I would help just any girl taken with Finder? You act as though Tithe girls have never fallen in love with him before. You know this is different.
A dark flush crept up Larkin's face. Of course, other girls would have been stricken with Finder. She could hardly blame them. But Larkin had never thought of them before. Never considered how she might not be the only one that found him so alluring. And oh, twins, what if Bridget had felt that way about him? A pang of sadness struck her heart at the thought of her friend. It had only been a little over a year since Finder had chosen Bridget, and her dearest friend in the world had been taken from her. The Starveling's magic had forced Finder to choose the girl who was the happiest, and he had chosen Bridget. And then, when the Starveling's magic had commanded him to, he had carved her heart from her chest. Larkin swallowed, guilt clawing at her. Finder had no choice but to kill Bridget. The Starveling's magic had forced him to. But she had grown so close to him during their travels. She had seen him for what he was and knew he was worth saving. She would never forget Bridget, would never fully forgive Finder for what he had done. But she still knew in the deepest part of her that he deserved to be saved, that he deserved to be king. Isra waved a hand.
Oh, force my hand, will you? I must know what makes Larkin so special.
Larkin knew that she and Saja had to take a risk,
or Isra would turn them away. She didn't trust Isra. She had learned the hard way not to be trusting of everyone she met, courtesy of Dahi. But it was a gamble she was going to have to take.
I saved his life.
Saja turned to her, eyes wide. Isra's brows lifted. Larkin took a deep breath.
Finder didn't choose me. He chose another girl from my village.
Larkin brought up Rosen's face in her mind. Dark hair, willowy frame, so like Bridget and yet.
Last year, my dearest friend, Bridget, was taken. She was like a sister to me. I was determined to find her, so when I didn't get chosen, I followed Finder and Rosen across the bridge into Erodian. I caught up with them just as they were brutally attacked by the Famari.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.